Han er filosof og stridsmand, og hans fjende er religion. Særligt det, han kalder giftig religion. Velkommen til Deadline anden sektion. Min gæst er amerikanske Daniel C. Dennett. De fleste kender de dramatiske billeder af ophidsede religiøse følelser. Af den blodige cocktail mellem religion og vold, som ikke mindst hærger den muslimske verden. Men religiøs fanatisme har også mere fredelige ansigter. For eksempel i USA, hvor kristne organisationer i årevis har ført en intens kamp mod videnskabens forståelse af verden. De kristne fundamentalisters kamp har fået en ny front til at rejse sig. Flere og flere højt ansete videnskabsmænd går i disse år til kamp mod den religiøse verden. De betragter religion som et resultat af hjernevask. Religion er roden til alt ondt, siger genetikeren Richard Dawkins. I bogen Breaking the Spell har Daniel C. Dennett sat sig for at analysere religion ud fra en darwinistisk synsvinkel. Hans konklusion er, at religion nærmest er en arvelig sygdom. Daniel Dennett, welcome to the program.
Call me Dan.
Thank you. Early in your book, you present a picture of how you look at religion. Tell us about the ant and the parasite.
Well, suppose you were out in the meadow and you saw an ant climbing up a blade of grass. And the ant climbs and climbs, and you flick it off, and it climbs again. It just keeps climbing. It's like Sisyphus rolling his rock until it gets to the very top of the grass. And you think, why is it doing this? This is a tremendous expenditure of time and energy. What benefit accrues to the ant from this behavior? Maybe it's hunting for food. Maybe it's showing off to catch a mate. No, that's not it. That's the wrong question. No benefit accrues to the ant at all. The ant's brain has been taken over by a little parasite, a little worm called Dicrocelium dendriticum, which needs to get into the belly of a cow or a sheep in order to continue its reproductive cycle. And so it commandeers an ant. It jumps into a passing ant and drives it up the blade of grass like an all-terrain vehicle in order to further its own genes. So the benefit accrues to the parasite, not to the ant. Now, that's a pretty scary and awful image in some ways. And yet, I point out that if you look at religions, they honor this theme. They say, the very word Islam in Arabic means submission or surrender of your own well-being to the well-being of Allah. And the same thing is true in Christianity, the idea that we surrender to God, we let God's will take over our own, and we certainly are prepared to sacrifice our own genetic benefit in order to further these ideas.
You compare religion to a parasite.
I do, yes. First of all, parasites aren't all bad. If we didn't have our many trillions of symbionts, we couldn't live. Some of them are dangerous for us, but the fact that they have their own independent fitness and that their lives and prospects are to some degree independent of our own and sometimes even antithetical, even in conflict with our own. This is a fundamental fact of biology. And I think it's very important to recognize that this is a distinct possibility in the world of culture, too. When I first started working on religion as a natural phenomenon, I ran into the following argument again and again. Somebody would say, oh, Dan, you're working on the evolution of religion. Well, what good do you think religion is? It's got to be some good. After all, every society that's ever been studied, it always has some kind of religion. So what do you think religion is for?
And what is it for?
And I said, well, that's the wrong question. Every society that has ever been studied has the common cold, too. What's that for? The common cold exists because it can exist. It's for itself. And we can't stop it. Now, maybe religion is like that. If you assume at the outset that religion's got to be good for something, you're missing half the hypotheses. Now, maybe religion is good for something. Maybe it's good for many things. Maybe it isn't. The fact that we find it everywhere doesn't prove one way or the other whether it's good for us. It might just be an infectious bad habit.
But if we look at the world right now, what is the essence of religion to you?
Well, first of all, as a good Darwinian, I don't like the term essence. Nothing really complicated and interesting has an essence, so there's varieties, and religions differ in all sorts of ways. Needing to restrict the term a bit, I make the essence of religion to be the belief in supernatural agents with whom we can interact. Now, some religions don't really meet that test, or some things that people call religions. Maybe Buddhism isn't a religion then. It's all right, because we can look at the whole family. We don't have to draw lines too sharply. I'm going to look both sides of the line in any case. But for me, a religion without God is like a vertebrate without a backbone.
Take an Elvis Presley fan club.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a religion?
Well, it could be. By my test, if the people in the fan club, if they think that Elvis is superhuman, if they think that Elvis is supernatural, if they think that Elvis can save them, if they think that Elvis is not an ordinary mortal, then it's a religion.
Many people do that, right?
Well, then for them it's a religion. But of course, the example is good because it shows that the line may not be that important. Things that used to be religions can cease to be religions without changing very much.
But do you identify an evolutionary necessity for religion for us human beings?
Evolutionary necessity in one sense, but not necessarily in others. I think that every feature of human culture is one fruit or another on the tree of life. In the same way that the beaver's dam is a evolutionary necessity for the beaver, so human culture and all of its specifics these things have evolved for reasons.
And what are the good reasons for religion? The pros.
Well, all right. Let's get right down to that, because we need to ask: good for whom? For the religion or for us?
For the society.
For the society as a whole.
Well, of course, religion can benefit individuals, yes, groups, yes. Society as a whole,
and also can benefit priests and preachers.
Yeah. But in an evolutionary perspective, if you should narrow your point, why do we cling to religion? Why do we value religion?
Well, I think for many reasons. First of all, religions have evolved a great deal over the last, say, 10,000 years. And most of the religions that have existed in that time have gone extinct. There have been thousands, hundreds of thousands of religions that have vanished without a trace. So the ones that we see today, these are the hardy survivors. These are religions that have stood the test of time. And they have done this by having adaptations that help to preserve them. So we can learn a great deal about human institutions by looking at religions, because they are fiendishly well designed. They're brilliantly designed to do the job they do. Well, what job is that? First, to get more members and to have solidarity, to have fellowship, to have tremendous loyalty and love. I think many people, they love their religion the way they love their spouses, the way they love their children. And harnessing that power of love is one of the most important features of religion, and helps to explain why, when you study religion scientifically, people get very nervous and very angry sometimes. In the same way as if somebody said, well, you're beloved. Let's put your beloved under the microscope. Let's examine and just see what makes this beloved of yours tick.